a very good afternoon to you from sunny Laufen here in Switzerland, where we're going to have the semi-finals and then the finals of the knockout sprint on this third round of the World Cup 2019. 18 athletes, 18 men and 18 women have already qualified for these semi-finals and finals, but we are going to see who becomes the winner of this relatively new format in orienteering and in sprint orienteering. We've got some very tough head-to-head races. We're going to see three semi-finals, each for the men and for the women, where only the top two of six qualify for that final, which will be going off later this afternoon. Then all six of those will race in the final to see who is crowned the winners of this knockout sprint. It's going to be taking place in amongst the old town of Laufen, lots of small little alleyways and also some route choices across the river here as well, and amongst some of the newer buildings, definitely for the semi-finals, going to provide a lot of choice. And then towards the finals, they're going to be going in more in and around the old town with some route choices, some barriers going to add the complication, so that it means that you really have to be on top of your game. Even though you're surrounded by lots of other runners, you really have to keep the concentration and keep the navigation looking good whilst maybe trying to save yourself with something for the end, for the sprint finish. So they're going to be progressing around here with the first semi-final. We were starting with the women's. That's going to be going off in just less than 8 minutes. They're going to be seeing a lot of these views of the arches, the underpasses here in the old town, and be faced with some navigational null challenges. And we can say there's going to be an element of choice, there's going to be an element of runner's choice, which I don't think the athletes are going to be too surprised about. They're all able to go to the big marquee yesterday evening and be able to see there will be some choice. This is what happened earlier today. There was a qualification, three heats of qualification, slightly different routes, and then the top 12 from there progressed into the quarterfinals. Here we can see, so three athletes going at a time. They're each running a slightly different course, and then it's the top 12 from each heat. And they had to really contend with this castle that where some of the bridge was closed off to them. There was a barrier, a lot of people having to stop and relook and rethink what they were going to do here, going and I think it caused some problems earlier in the competition. Some of the favourites, particularly, or these contenders, particularly in the men's class, happened. And then this is where, from the qualification, the athletes chose which heat they wanted to be in, sorry, which quarterfinal they wanted to be in. We're kind of make sure you even out some of who the best ones are in each of those quarterfinals. And then this is the quarterfinal. They all started at once, six runners going off at a time, and it was the first three to cross the line who made it into the semi-finals that we're going to have today. Bit different terrain here, some of these larger residential buildings, and there was kind of like there were loops here as well, like what they weren't expecting, a map change as well, so they didn't feel like they were running around everybody the whole time. And so then the top three from there have progressed through into the semi-finals. So the semi-finals, we're going to start with the women's course, and we've got an estimated winning time of around, well, 6 to 8 minutes, although I did it in 9 and a little bit earlier on, so they're going to go way, way faster than I am. I think it's going to be absolutely rapid. The men's semi-final is a bit longer. Again, the same expected winning time. You know, chat us through the course.
Yep. And as you mentioned before, we have this runner's choice here in the very beginning. So the runners, they choose which option they want to have in the beginning, seeing all three of them on different maps at the start. So the beginning of the course might be a bit confusing to follow, but we will see them all together again at number three and see which option that's the fastest one. Very interesting leg from control 5 to 6. Either you back out from the control to the left, or you go to the right, and then you have to take the stairs. 6, 7, another route choice. And as you mentioned before, it's quite a short loop here. So they are already on the way back. Some more short controls. Now we enter the old town of Laufen here. And we see the difference of the women's and the men's course. And 11, that's the second last control, or 13 in the men's class, and then 2:14 and back to the finish. So what we can say, there are some meters to the start point. They get some time to read the map there. Of course, they already knew the first control since they were choosing it at their runner's choice. But they only get a few seconds to take a look at it. It's a very quick decision they have to make. I think they would go after what they think is easiest to execute. Usually the differences are not very, very big of the three options. It's not about giving someone a disadvantage by these different options. It's more about splitting up the runners so that they can't just follow each other. So we expect all the three options here to be approximately
the same. And as you can see from the distances there, C is 10 meters further, but it's also about execution and being able to flow through the controls as well. With the touch-free punching, you can just keep going, and maybe they'll want to think about that too.
So I think when you have the three options there, you take a look at them and you try to see where do I have to take the least decisions on the way, so it's easiest to execute. And often you get a feeling quite quickly if a leg is more or less difficult than the other one. And I think you don't have the time, they're not printed on the same map, so you have to compare between different maps, and you don't have a lot of time, you have to be very quick in your decision. So I think that's the only thing you can go after.
Yeah, so yeah, as you said, those three options, A, B, and C, will be on separate maps when they go into the start box. As they're doing now, they'll have 20 seconds to do it. So we will start with the first semi-final, the first of three. So we've got Drizzy Sikova, the Czech junior, Sal Hagström, Lillian Forsgren, both from Sweden, Elena Ross, and the from Switzerland, and Julia Jakob from Switzerland, and Alice Leake from Britain as well. So it's quite a very new format, so we're not really sure all of, you know, everybody's form, how well we're expecting people to do here, as well as the fact that there's been a focus on the forest orienteering for the last year, so a lot of these people are having to change over from that.
Yeah, first of all, I mean, we haven't seen them compete in knockout sprint very often, and then it's the runner's choice. We don't really know what option they take, and we don't know which of the open options is the fastest, so it's very hard to predict here. We will see. There are, of course, the fast runners. If they are fast from the last control to the finish, they often have an advantage, but I mean, you have to be there as well, so let's see.
Okay, so they're about to make their choice. They've been introduced to the crowd, and they're going to have 20 seconds.
So now they go back there, and they will get the different options. So now they get the three options on different maps there, and they have to decide which option they go for, A, B, or C. And then they pick the map accordingly to this letter they have been looking at.
So they've taken the map that corresponds to that letter. They've taken the rolled up map and they're not allowed to open it as well. Let's have a look. Julia Jakob's chosen C. And so too has Lillian Forsgren. B from Tozi Anasikova. C from Alice Leake as well. Three C's so far. Sarah Hagström is on A. So too Eleanor Ross. So Tozi Anasikova is the only one doing B. Will that be interesting for her? Maybe it's better to run with more people and do C. But a few seconds now till the start. And taking a look at their maps, getting on the start line.
I would say a good job by the course planners. All the options were picked in this first heat.
And now they're going to go and turn right out of this arena. And there's quite a longer route out into the start point here, and you've really got to be trying to attack this course. The Czech junior Tereziana Tikhova has already gone to the front. Eleanor Ross is also there too, so too Julia Jakob. And the start control's just around the corner, and from there they've got to they will start to split up and go their different routes. Can you see the start? There's a start control, and now they're going to be splitting up, so they're going to go different routes until they get to control number three. And remember, they've chosen this option, but what they don't know is what everybody else has chosen. They don't know who is good to follow, but I think really aggressive start from Jana Sokova, the Czech athlete who's really pushing it.
Yeah,
so
of course, if you feel that you have a great shape, it's good to try to open a gap in the beginning, since you know that's where you will have different courses and you can actually build up a gap without letting the others just following you.
But Jana Sokova is the only one who's got B, so she's going to go from 1B to 2B, which is the further west control. And remember, there's not really too much between them. It's more about splitting the runners up and making sure that they're going different routes. You can see Ross and Hagstrom, they've both got option A, but they're both going those different routes. Meanwhile, those who've chosen C all sticking together through this point, but still not much between it. Now it looks like Jana Sokova is a long way in the front, but she's still got to go back on herself now and get the second control on option B. And it's only again when they go to control number three, which is on this small tree, that they'll be together. But it looks like Alice Leake of Great Britain leading that group who chose the C option, and we're really soon going to see them on the picture coming to cross over coming around the road. This is control number four we're looking at here on the edge of the fence, and it is the Czech athlete first, Jana Sokova, who's first, followed by Ross of Switzerland, followed by Leake of Great Britain, and then Forsgren. And Jakob is a little bit further behind. So from this point on, they all have the same option. But what we're going to see is the different options that they choose. There's some route choices, particularly on the next two controls. So Jana Sokova goes right. Will they all do that? Yes, they will.
Of course, they know at this point they have the same course, mm-hmm. since it was announced that it would be either... The loops, it would be the runner's choice, or there would be no forking. So
yes.
they've already had the runner's choice, so they know that it's unforked from here. We have a small gap here from the Swiss runner, Elena Roos and Jana Sokova, and the others following there. But that's already some meters, and we know that only the first two runners will make it to the final.
Yes, they've managed to open up a gap on Alice Leake in third, and they're choosing to go straight on at this control. There was another opportunity to do some route choice here, but they've managed to go through the control, and then that'll also allow them to do the same when they go from control 7 to 8 as well. So really trying to attack here as they cross the river, and they know really there's only a few more controls to go, and I'd say the most difficult orienteering part of it has already happened. It's a little bit easier on this stage.
I don't know if it's easier, but it's less stressful now. You know it's unforked. You know these big differences in route choices and splitting up of the runners is over. And now you can go on with the normal kind of sprint orienteering you're used to do.
You can see these two runners at the front really chopping and changing, being more aggressive. Those further back maybe just checking, being very careful about their choices as they punch control 8.
They were very strict there to take the passage over the street.
Yeah, well, the rest is marked out of bounds, so yeah, do that. And then they will go left here, and they've got one more tree, and then they're going to go be on the next section here. They are already on their way to control number 10.
Yeah, and now we are entering the old town here, so the kind of orienteering is changing. Now, before it was more these big houses, some kind of route choices to the left or to the right, and now you have to look out for some passages, smaller passages as well. And it opens up for route choices. We are following Elena Ros here, and we have seen that Jana Sikova continued.
I think Elena Ros was the better option on there, but it's really hard to tell. Let's see. We're going to follow her to control number 11 now. She's going to take a right hand down here, and has she managed to get a gap?
I mean, the distance, it was not a big difference in the distance, and Jana Sikova had the advantage that she could just continue to run there, since this air punching, you don't really have to stop at the control. She could just keep on running into the same direction as she did before. Here, there's actually an option as well to back out again from the control and go to the left.
Alice Leek's doing.
Yeah.
And she will go this way round, and now we're on for a race. This is interesting. So that was a good choice there from Alice Leek, and they've got the final section to go now. Three of them, only two of them are going to make it to the final. Who's going to make it there? As Jana Sikova is the first one across the line, followed by Ros, followed by Alice Leek, who took a good risk there, but it didn't quite pay off on the run-in. So qualifying to the final, we have Jana Sikova from the Czech Republic, and we have Elena Ros as well, as the rest of the competition cross the line and finish their routes.
And one thing we can tell here after this first hit is that it's very good to back out from control 11 to control 12 in the very end. So interesting, with an option there in the very end if you're kind of desperate some meters behind, as Alice Leek was. She had to do something, she tried something, and I mean,
it very nearly worked. Paid off. Yeah, yeah. That was, and I think if you are in that position as Alice was, you do have to make
of
a
course.
Risk,
I mean,
like that.
There were some meters, the gap of some meters. She knew from before she didn't really make it just physically to close the gap. What should I do? There's only one control left. I have to try something. Here I get the chance. I take it, and it was very close.
So this is how it was run, and Jana Sikova really like attacking out of the start.
There would be a different option as well for Jana Sikova to go to the right there for control B. Hard to say what's faster, but she could run with the other runners there in the beginning of the leg at least. But since she was in front there, she didn't see what the others are doing, so it was Jana Sikova herself deciding the route choice there. Here we got the feeling that there was a small gap opening from Elena Ros to Alice Leek. See, maybe we can figure out how much time Alice Leek won on the route choice in the very end.
So Jana Sikova goes the other way. Oh, was that a mistake from Yulia Yakov?
Yeah,
I think
She didn't find the entrance there. Let's see, maybe it was maybe 3-4 seconds. She won by backing out from control 11 again.
Yeah, we say it won 3-4 seconds, but that's that's enough to make that kind of a difference.
Yeah, I mean it's about, let's say, 10 meters.
Yeah.
And that's quite much in a competition like this.
Yeah, it really is. So advancing through to the final, Jana Sikova and Ros, they two will have to wait and see who will join them in the final. And of course, having a little I think they've just got the map there to show them where they can recover between the two rounds, between the semi-final and the final, and where they can go, and having a little chat about the races and everything too. But very shortly, we're going to move on to the second of the three semi-finals. And we can introduce the women who are going to be running in this second semi-final, all lining up there. We've got Sabine Hausfeld from Switzerland. She was fourth place in the knockout sprint when it was last held in Prague in the World Cup. Andrina Benny-Minson, she's also there. She was fifth in that same race. We've got Natalia Gempeler, who very nearly didn't qualify. She was only in 12th. This is Sabine Halsewit here, Anthony Benjaminson here, the Norwegian. We've also got Megan Carter-Davis, Simona Abasold, who of course took a silver medal yesterday in the middle distance, and Sandra Gosberger as well. So yes, Natalia Gempeler very nearly didn't qualify. She was in 12th place, and it was only the top 12 to qualify. Megan Carter-Davis in there, finished second in her set quarterfinal. Simona Abasold, a big hope. She was able to have quite a nice, easy run into the finish in the quarterfinals, looking very good. And Sandra Gosberger is also in there as well. They've been asked to step back, and they're going to be presented with the options. So they've been instructed they can start their decision. They've got 20 seconds now to decide A, B, or C. There's really not much in it at all. It's more to separate the athletes, but hopefully we'll get a good spread of what people decide. It also just puts a little bit more pressure on the athletes. They may be second-guessing themselves. All these thoughts, all these emotions going through their head, and now they've got to make that decision, pick up the map, and we're going to find out which one they've chosen. So Anthony Benjaminson and Natalia Gempeler both chosen C. C was a popular choice in Heat 1. So to Simona Abasold's also chosen C. Megan Carter-Davis and Sandra Gosberger B, and to Sabine Halsewit. So nobody has chosen the A option. It is B or C. So that is what is going to happen. And there's a few seconds now to the start of this second semi-final. Six women on the start line, only two to progress through to the final. And they are off, they are underway, and they will be familiar with the first section of the course. That was the athlete's choice part. They run out of the arena, round the corner, and head towards the start triangle, where the navigation begins. And already Sabine Halsewit has really aggressively gone out of this start. So too there's Simona Abasold and Natalia Gempeler. And they've got to go round this corner towards the start triangle. But very aggressive start from Sabine Halsewit.
I think it's a technical decision by Sabine Halsewit to be leading in the beginning. The advantage is that you don't see the others, and there's no risk that you get the others take influence on your decision. So you can do your own race from the very top of this group, and you don't get the others and don't get distracted and might follow the others. But you can do your own choices, and that's very nice when you're in a stressful situation like this.
Yeah, and runners, you know, when they're doing the sprint by themselves at the time trial, they're used to not seeing anybody ahead of them. They're used to being able to do everything at their own pace. But so now we can see this is how the two groups have split up, very close together. And you can see those different options. So half of them picking the option B, half of them picking option A. And you can see the ones that are doing B, they've taken that other route choice. So I remember Janosikova chose to go the southernmore route.
Yeah,
left.
It feels a bit more round when you're running there and not as edgy. You don't have to run to the left and then go around the corner there that much. So I think it's a less distance.
But this is the group that chose the option B. Sabine Halsewit there, followed by Megan Carter-Davis. We've also got off the back Sandra Gosberger, the Latvian. So we're going to see them again. We've got a camera just overlooking control number four. And this looks like, from here, looks like B was a good option, possibly. And maybe they've had a little bit of a gap on the C runners. It's going to be tight. It's going to be really difficult to see. But this is where we're going to see what's happening. So Halsewit first, Carter-Davis in second. We've got Gempeler, then Abasold, and then Gosberger. So B was a little bit of a better option than C, it looks like.
And now it's tough for both Gempeler and Abasold, because they have to close the gap just physically. They have to, or they can hope for a small mistake by the two runners in front. But even if they can, now we see that there's
oh. Was that Abasold or was that Gempeler?
I think it was Gempeler, but I'm not 100% sure.
We're going to have to see who it was by the time they get to the other side of the building. But second guessing yourself But even, at this point.
As I said before, even if they can close the gap, they spend more energy in closing it. So when it comes to the very last meters, they have used more energy than the other. And I think it was Kempele backing out from the control there, because now we have Abersold up there in the top three again.
So Carter Davis leading, then Hauseret, then Abersold, then Gempele. It's going to be two of these four. I'm pretty certain of that one. But Gempele, yeah, remember we saw her go left and go back on herself and certainly lost a few meters on that point. You can see that gap opening up as they get on the move away from the steps. But still, Carter Davis leading ahead of Hauseret.
She looks very strong today. No hesitating at all. And it seems that she is pushing very hard here, trying to keep the others behind her.
So they will go in here for control number seven. You can see here the whistles, traffic being stopped, making sure they have this clear run. And now only a few more controls to go. And looks like this group of three kind of getting a little bit away from Natalia Gempele. So they punch the control there. That's number eight. And then go into the old town. And you've really got to keep calm, keep confidence in this last section of orienteering. We saw some people, Yulia Jakob, making a mistake here, but also there are some route choice options. So here they go, punching control number eight and turning around and splitting up at this point to go to control number 10.
And a good tactic now for a runner like Abersold would be, could be, since you know that it's on the fork, you can really look ahead and try to see is the route choice coming in the very end and try to prepare this one.
So now they're punching control number 10 and they've all gone the same way this one. We think it was possibly a little bit slower than the other option, which is to back out of the control, but pretty similar here. So Carter Davis leading Hauseret, and I think just behind in the picture is Abersold as well. So Megan Carter Davis looking really strong here. Only two more controls to go. Oh, Abersold went the other way, so that's interesting. We think that one was a little bit quicker, but we can't see her in the picture. This is control number 11 around here, and then we've got to decide which way are they going to go here. And Carter Davis just hesitating, but goes straight on, and now we're going to see what happens on this section, as we think that Hauseret's chosen the better option. So too Natalia Gempele.
So that means that they should be all together at control 12, more or less. Will be very exciting to see. Here we have Hauseret.
This is Hauseret and Megan Carter-Davis here too. Natalia Gempele here. And they're now fighting for the top three. Abersold's out of it. But is it going to be between these three runners? So Hauseret's got it clear. Natalia Gempele's here is too. But Megan Carter-Davis is chasing her down. It's not going to be enough. Hauseret qualifies. Natalia Gempele comes back from her mistake. And Megan Carter-Davis again just edged out of it. Simona Abersold, possibly a shock fourth place for her, crosses the line.
So what we definitely can say now after two hits, it's good to back out both from control 10 and 11. I think that's very interesting because your intuition says just keep going towards the direction you are heading to from the beginning. It's always hard to stop and back out, but in this case here, it's better than both, at both controls.
But I think Simona Abersold chose the going back out to from 10 to 11, and she lost that. She lost the time on that one. But anyway, we have Hauseret and Gempele going to advance to the final. They're going to join Janosíková and Ross there, and they will wait and see who are the next two to qualify. Congratulations there. Sabina Hauseret said she really enjoyed the qualification and the quarterfinal where they had the loop, something a bit different, mixing up the different options that we can have on this knockout sprint competition, with loops being one of the options, just a straight race being another option with no differences in routes, and the athlete's choice being another option. But those are the results with, said they were going pretty close to those 6 minutes for the very, very fast, and those who they are the ones who've qualified.
So here we see again the different options. Interesting here that everyone on choice B took another choice than Janosikova in the first heat. Seemed to be slightly faster here, B than C. And let's see again then later on the very decisive part in the very end. Here we have seen Gempele with a small mistake, first turning out, backing up from control 5. Was some seconds behind at that point, was able to fight back, her way back to the top and later on the course. This part here, 7, 8, 9, very much running all the way, more or less, to control 10. And then we have this two route choices. Should you go back out again? Or not? Yeah, it might be some seconds slower to back out, hard to say. But here it's definitely faster to go to the left, turn around directly. It's a bit hard to do it when you're in the top of the group because you know the runners coming behind you and you don't want to crash into them. So it's, yeah, it takes some, you have to be very sure that it's faster to do it. Otherwise, it's very comfortable to just keep on running.
Mm. And I think it's about having, have you made that decision before you get there? Because I think you could see Megan Carter-Davis hesitating there and she hadn't really made that decision. Maybe she'd seen the options, but she hadn't 100% decided what she was going to do. And it's that hesitation as well as the route choice that made the difference. So we're on to the final semi-final here, the last of three. Martina Ruch is in lane one. Tove Alexandersen has three individual wins of this World Cup 2019, taking the gold in yesterday's middle distance. But she's pretty good at sprint too, so which is an understatement.
Well, it's fair to say that she's pretty good at sprint too, yeah.
Silja Grolijaren, she's in lane three. We have Paula Gross in lane four. We have Victoria Heistad-Bjørnstad in lane five. And we have Lotta Kahola in lane six. Now, Tove Alexandersen is the big favorite from this heat. And I think actually with the rest of the runners, I think it's quite open actually with who can take that second spot. I think actually as a runner who's not confident of qualifying, I mean, nobody's really confident of qualifying, anything could happen, but this is a good, I'd say this is a good semi-final to be in anyway. They are making their decisions, looking at A, B and C. We saw from the last semi-final that B was a good option, better than C anyway, so they're having to look at all of the options. As you can see, they're on separate maps. It's really hard to see and compare which is the best, but let's have a look at which options they take. They've grabbed their map and they've got 30 seconds to the start. We're going to see what options they've chosen. Silja Grolijaren, and she has chosen C, so too has Paula Gross. We saw a mixture of C and B. C again, proving the most popular. C2, Lotta Kahola is the only one to choose B. Martina Ruch is the only one to choose A. So four athletes on C. Not quite yet. They've got to wait for the clapperboard. Almost a little bit of a false start there as these six women on the start line for this third and final semi-final here. And now the six of them begin their race. Only two to qualify for the final to fill those last two spots on the final taking place later on this afternoon. And already hitting the front, Victoria Heistad-Bjørnstad has really aggressively got out of the blocks. It's over Alexandersen and the rest all grouped behind her. Now they're going to go to the start triangle, which is to the right, and then make their choices. So we know four of them are doing option C. So it's only Lotta Kahola, the Finn, and Martina Ruch who are going to be going different ways. So you can see all these four women all going towards, in fact there should be five of them because it's the same same number one for a couple of the options.
Yeah, there's an option to go more to the left around. Less decisions to take there, but they were splitting up. I don't think they should have been splitting up there, should they? To control A, that's control.
Unless Martina, that's probably Martina Ruch, I think that was, who was going a different route to control that route to control A.
Here.
You can see this is. So now going up the track and out onto the road.
Still see very aggressive start by Björn Snod. But as I mentioned before, I think that's a good tactic. I mean, it's very hard to close the gap again when it's once it's open. It's easier to stay up there, and she has Alexandersen around her, so that's very comfortable to have, to know that she's there, because then, yeah, if you're around Tove, you're in a good place.
Yes, but I mean, well, Alice Leek was certainly saying she was had it as a tactic to go to the start in the quarterfinals, where she was more confident of qualifying. But I think when you're doubting yourself, you're kind of holding back, thinking you have to have more in reserve, and then that's when I think you start dropping down the pack. But Alexandersen, now she's the only one to go the other route here, and of course they're all following her. Why would you do anything else?
Yeah, it's very interesting to see here. It's the first runner in the pack has a... Yeah, I can very much decide where everyone is going, and a lot of power and power position powerful position for the first runner.
So Alexandersen here, Victoria Hestad-Bjørnstad is next, and then we have the two Swiss runners. And yes, they go straight on, which is
I think
not a surprise.
Once again, Ruch, we haven't seen before. Since they're coming from another direction, you don't want to back out again, so they just continue here. It doesn't matter. I mean, as long as everyone is taking the same route, no one cares about which one's the fastest.
No. No, and I think at this point in the race, you're not taking those risks. It's the last few controls where you want to take risks and see if you can get ahead of the others.
Yeah, but the gaps here are already quite big. So some of the runners, like Paula Gross, Lotta Karula, Silja Krolyaden, they actually could take another route just to risk something, because the gap here is already so big that without a mistake from the first two runners, they won't be able to make it up there, and they have to be among the two first positions to make it to the final.
This is really impressive from the young Norwegian, Victoria Hestad-Bjørnstad. I mean, we expect it from Tove Alexandersen, but the Norwegian's really hot on her heels, and look, you can see already that the gap that they have over Martina Ruch, who's the next in third place. But as long as nothing goes wrong for these top two now, they are pretty clear of the rest and should be able just to keep up that pace and be good for the final. So into the Old Town now, they've got a few more controls to go. But Martina Ruch is, it's difficult to tell from the perspective where the camera shortens the angles, but at this point we can't see anybody taking as many risks or anything. And these are the two in the lead at the moment. Tove Alexandersen trying to keep her winning streak going throughout the whole of 2019, and I'm not really sure from the GPS what's happened there. Maybe some of those further back choosing different route choices, but it's not going to be enough. I think the advantage they'll get from those route choices is not quite enough, but actually we thought it was just those two quite clear to get that qualification, but now there's still three in this race and they've all chosen the slower option.
Yeah, there the chance for Martina Ruch would have been there to back out again, but she thinks that she can do it just physically, And she's quite close there.
Seconds in it. Oh, but she fancies her chances. You can really see this now. We're the three of them now racing for the line, but we haven't really seen many people be able to pass each other on this finish line. But Martina Rook is going to be able to do it. Tove Alexanderson clear in the lead, but Martina Rook is going to qualify for the final, just pipping Victoria Hestad Bjørnstad into third place, and that is very impressive pacing there from the Swiss runner.
Well, now in the very end, you have to say well played, because if she really felt it beforehand that she is stronger physically than Hestad Bjørnstad, then of course it was a good decision to follow. Are you confident that you can close this 5-6-7 meters gap? Then of course, why should you take the risk and go around? But how sure can you be that you will be so much faster in the end?
That's quite brave running, I think, there. Well, from both of them, but those two different tactics being taken, knowing how you can sprint over such a short period of time. Well, we knew that this was a pretty open one. Tove Alexanderson, we were pretty sure, would qualify in first position, but Martina Rook battling it out there with Victoria Hestad Bjørnstad was really great to see, and she's rewarded with a place in that final. That will go off, of course, later on this afternoon. We will have all the men's semi-finals next, and then moving on to the finals. But at this point, no time for celebrating. Immediately on to some recovery. Go straight into, or at least no time for Tove Alexanderson to celebrate. Immediately into some recovery, thinking about the final, getting herself into that space. Those are confirmation of the results in the end. A little bit slower, that one, I think, in the actually compared to the second semi-final, but Alexanderson didn't need to do any more than that.
You have seen them choosing differently in the middle part of the race. I think there would have been a chance for runners behind to actually get a match, or to take some risks against Alexanderson. I'm not really sure if she has chosen right there from control 4 to 5 and then 6 to 7. So here we see them in the beginning, very, very much Alexanderson and very much Hestad Bjørnstad there in the lead. Actually, at this point, I thought that there's a good chance for Hestad Bjørnstad. I think she did it right tactically to try everything from the beginning and see if it works or not. I mean, it's a lot of risk you take if you save some energy in the beginning, especially when you have a runner like Alexanderson in your heat, that if she once opens a gap, it's very hard for the runners behind to catch up again. So I think it was tactically smart to stay there for the Norwegian runner. In the end, it was also a bit, I mean, she was a bit unlucky that Rook really never gave up and felt that she has the power to be up there. I think in another heat she might have made it.
Yeah, I agree. I think she did nothing wrong by attacking it from the start, especially when it's such a short amount of time to be out on the course, so much shorter than the more classic sprints, the time trial sprint. And really, that's exactly how you have to do it, because if you're losing some meters throughout the race, then it's really going to impact it. So that's the women's semi-finals done and dusted. We're going to move on to that final will be a bit later on. We're going to move on to the men's. Again, we have three semi-finals, six men in each heat, six men in each semi-final, top two to go through. So the start list for semi-final number one. It's a pretty packed one, I think. You can see them lining up there. We've got Matthias Kibertz, and a big favourite. He's the European sprint champion, and it didn't run yesterday. Ralph Street also lines up. Not been doing much sprinting recently, been mostly focusing on the forest in Norway. Tobias Pizzati Bong Young, Swiss runner. Chris Jones is here. He's the European bronze medalist in the sprints and has been focusing a lot on athletics and running recently, so not sure, not been orienteering with the map very much, has been running. And in lane six, we have Olav Lundenes.
King of the forest.
King of the forest.
On the sprint track.
On the sprints.
Actually,
I mean,
quite... for me, it was a little surprise that he made it to the final. I mean, you have to go head-to-head, of course, and you know that he has the speed. But it's something else on asphalt. It's something else on sprint, and everyone knows it's not his favorite thing to do, run around the houses. he prefers trees to orienteer in, so that's, or around. So it's... But it's impressive. I mean, if he wants to go for the World Cup overall victory, he has to be good in sprint as well. And that's the first step.
So it's exactly the same procedure as for the women's. And we can have a look and see what they've chosen. Olav Lundenes has chosen C. It's the same options. Chris Jones has got B. Matthias Kivertz has got A. B also for Lexi Niemi. A for Tobias Pizzati. And Ralph Streets, what is he going to choose? Not sure. Well, we'll have to wait and see which one he's chosen. But a good spread, a good mix, not as as we saw with the women's, with C being very popular. But they're on the start line now, these six, two to progress through to the final. And they are immediately out of the blocks with the two Swiss athletes heading immediately to the front of the pack. And they're going to go straight out of this arena. The orienteering will commence. So Matthias Kivertz in the lead there.
And look at the gap down to Niemi. I think there must have happened something in the very beginning.
I think he just didn't have that acceleration out.
No. I think there's something else going on.
Oh.
I think he injured himself there on the first meters. There's no way he would lose that much distance or time already in the beginning.
So six becomes five, and this is interesting. They've all hit the road again to go round to this option here, and looks like Matthias Kibert's already starting to stretch out that pack. We've got Chris Jones in next, then Pizzati. And they all go around this corner. And maybe this point they'll be... So Ralph Street's also chosen A, we can see there. But maybe...
A or B, we don't know that. Yeah, there, A for Ralph Street. So five
guys fighting for the two places. And Chris Jones has got B. We knew that was a pretty good option to go at least that way round on option B, and they were able to get some time there. So just losing a little bit of the GPS in here. Matthias Kibbert's choosing this different route choice to go from 2A to 3, but it's 3 where they will be joined back up together, and then they have the same routes for the rest of the course. So it's hard to see here. So they're going to approach this third control. Looks like Chris Jones will have that lead. A good option to choose B, and this is control number 4. So from this point on, they have exactly the same controls. Who are we going to go see through this point first? It looks like this is Chris Jones, followed by Matthias Kibbert, followed by Ralph Street, and then Tobias Pizzati. These four have got a gap. No, we haven't seen Olav Lundenes yet, and Alexi Niemi, again, we're not really sure what's happened to him. Something right out of the start gate, something went wrong, and now they're going to choose these options. So they head to the right, as we saw most of the women's team doing. Ah, but Tobias Pizzati, he's chosen the different option. He's going to have to go all the way around here, and now we're going to see which of these is the fastest.
I mean, for him, it's tough. There are runners like Kibbutz, like Chris Jones, incredibly fast runners, and of course, Tobias Pizzati is very fast as well, but he gets the feeling, you could see that he has to do something special to be able to match the other runners, and it looks quite good for him. Good choice by Pizzati.
Oh, and they've all chosen to go back round the other options. Those four still together. There we can see Lundenaires, and he's just behind, like significantly behind the others. And his race surely must be over. So it's going to be two of these four. As we see Kiberts first, then we see Chris Jones, then Pezzati, then Street. So two of these four will progress through to the final. Two Swiss and two British athletes. And it looks like there may be a little bit of a gap forming there with Kiberts in the lead, then Jones. But I mean, pretty much this point's too much between them. So this is control number seven.
And now they have a slightly longer course compared to the women before. It's pushing very hard here, Matthias Kiberts.
And interestingly, those two at the lead didn't run yesterday. But very close here between the four of them. This is control number nine, and then splitting up here as well as they go to control number 10. Maybe these ones going to the right, choosing to avoid the steps, but they've got to be really careful to see this little gap in. It basically looks like you're going in a building, you go down some passages, and
actually,
that's quite interesting.
In there, it's very dark when you go in there, so you don't see anything in the very beginning.
Yeah, it really puts you off. And this is why the GPS is going totally crazy, because they're inside a building, essentially, and then they're going to come out again and go towards control number 11. My guess is, again, they will go back down to this main street. But it looks like two Swiss runners in the lead here. All four of them pretty much still very close together, but maybe paid off for Pezzati as you see Ralph Street here in fourth. So now they're going to change directions again. Some of them going over to the right, some of them to the left. I think it's very, very similar between them.
I really like the way Pezzati is handling this challenge here. He is going, he's doing his own race. He is taking the risk when he thinks that it's worth to do it. And look at it, now he's in the lead.
And they all turn around and go the same way. So two runners from Switzerland, two from Britain in here into control number 13. And now it's going to be interesting to see where they go, 13, 14, and to the finish, as there's options to win some time if you back out of this next control. So they go into the control round here. This is control number 13. And you're going to win time if you back out of this one. Kiberts goes straight on. Everybody does, apart from Ralph Street. Now that's interesting. Will Ralph Street be able to get a gap by choosing this option? Will he be able to just sneak ahead? It's going to be really tight between the four of them.
Very well played by Ralph Street. I mean, this was maybe his only chance. And now he is in the lead.
Ralph Street with that decision, and Chris Jones is in second place. So Ralph Street, he's going to qualify surely with this run. And now it's a big sprint on between Chris Jones and Matthias Kiberts to get the two qualifying spots. Ralph Street qualifies, and second place, Chris Jones. Oh, just edging out Matthias Kiberts. What a fantastic finish. To Tobias Pezzati didn't have the sprint in the end. So, Ralph Street, Chris Jones, both through to the final. Matthias Kiberts in fourth place, but what a big decision for Ralph Street to make to go back out there and go round.
That was actually a very interesting heat here. We had Tobia Pezzati was very, very active throughout the whole course. I really liked his way of orienteering here. It's a pity for him that it didn't make it all the way to the final, but you have to say, the Brits, they played it perfectly here in the end. Ralph Street, he noticed that this is his only chance. Well, I don't know what Niemi is doing.
I think he just kind of jogged out. Maybe he was injured from the start and just...
wants to get
the
points.
Yeah.
But back to Ralph Street. I mean, he had the disadvantage at the second last control, but he was aware of, I mean, there was no hesitating in deciding the route, so he was reading on beforehand. He knew exactly what he has to do or what he wants to do, and it was a very good decision. And I think for Kiberts, it would have been better with a straight run in here without the curve, because he had to speed up, break down again, and then speed up again. And that's good for the one in front, and it's really bad for the one behind, also with the curve.
Yeah, it's quite a tight and short run in, especially for the spectators here in the arena, the confirmation of those results from the Spurs semi-final.
Before, perfectly played by the Brits. Very well done. If you have the strength, ask Chris Jones to run very fast, do it. If you have, if you're a smart guy, Ralph Street in the end, yeah, you can get an advantage of that. I mean, everyone else would have had that chance as well. So here we see them again. Now we start to see the active orienteering of Pezzati. First time here at the fifth control. It was the first time he could win some of the seconds back. And a rude choice. We will see that again later on the course. The whole group here more or less together during the whole course. Here we see that Pezzati is going to the left again. And then suddenly being in the lead at control 11. They are splitting up again to 12. And then here we have this last part of the course where you see Rolf Street backing out from the control again and winning the heat by the smart decision in the very end.
Yeah, I think that's good planning, that there's the ability to take the risks right at the end to win a significant amount of seconds, and you could really see that. Anyway, let's move on to the second of three semi-finals. You can see them lining up there. It'll be presented to the crowd here. And in lane one, we have Daniel Hoopman. Silver medal yesterday. He is the reigning world and European champion. In lane two, we have the Czech athlete Wojtek Kral, who won the knockout sprint when it was held in the World Cup last time in Prague. Riccardo Skelet is here in lane three, the Italian. And in lane four, Emil Svensk, who had a fantastic sprint finish to only just qualify by about 20 centimetres, I think it was, ahead of Chris Millard. Gustav Bennemann, he is going in lane five. He took the bronze medal last time he had a knockout sprint in the World Cup. And in six, Peter Parfinovitz. So they make their decisions. They're presented with the map to have a look, and they can see those three options to make their decision.
Parfinovitz was kind of a surprise this morning. He did a very good race in a tough heat there. We had a big sprint, as you said it before, where Chris Mithert was just pushed out from the semi-final on the last meters by Emil Svensk.
So they've made their decision. It's exactly the same decision, A, B, or C, that we've seen in all of these semi-finals. They've taken their map, they've got it rolled up. So they're going to be on this yellow line, ready to start. We're going to have a look. Wojtek Kral's chosen C. B from Emil Svensk. That's a good one if he executes it well. Riccardo Skelet also C. C2 from Gustav Bennemann. Choose it, proving to be a popular option. Parfenovitz taking A, and again C from Daniel Hoopman. So four Cs again. Emil Svensk in B and Parfenovitz in A. So second semi-final. Six men on the start line. Only two will make it through. And Parfenovitz going to the front already. Daniel Hoopman in second place. The two Swedes at the back at the moment. This is such a tactical affair, even on this immediate first part of the course. And it's really good tactics. You're not doing yourself any harm to head to the front, although the pole just being making sure he actually goes to this start control that you can see there. There's a start control, and now the orienteering is going to begin. Remember, we've got four men who've chosen option C, one who's chosen A, one who's chosen B. Gustav Bennemann, he's one of the ones who's chosen C.
Also Wojtek Kral. So we see that Hoopman and Skelet, they are actually choosing a different route choice to this option C here compared to the other two runners, Bennemann and Kral.
So yeah, four going to option C, but then they've split up into two to go to that choice. Svensk and Parfinovitz are the only ones going to that easterly control number one, and then they're going to be split up again. Which is losing some of the GPS tracking through the buildings.
But I think the option Berryman and Kral were choosing there was some seconds faster compared to the Hopman Skalé option. Here we have Emil Svensk and Piotr Parfianowicz.
Emil Svensk's choosing option B. I think it's another one that's going to play out for him, but we're not going to know exactly what it is. This is control three that we can see. He's just about to punch, and looks good for the Swede. Collision there with the camera, I think. There's Wojtek Kral from the Czech Republic. He's already got a win in a knockout sprint. There's only been one held in the World Cup so far.
That's really bad by the cameraman. They shouldn't be in the way there. They should take some steps back.
So I think we've met Emil Svensk is actually further to the left of picture. He's just ahead, but you see Wojtek Kral, you can see it's just a little bit of acceleration to go and overtake the pole in there. Now let's see what the options are. So Emil Svensk in the lead, and he backs out, no hesitations there. Will they all do the same? Oh, nope. They nearly do, but...
A mistake,
and Gustav Berryman is able to hit the lead. So Emil Svensk not quite reading all that fine detail.
I mean, we've seen before that this option backing out was good when Pezzati chose to take it, but of course they did a mistake there some seconds, so I expect Hopman to be in the lead now, together with Skalé.
So they've chosen the other option and executed it better. And then Daniel Hoopman now into the lead. And they all cross over and go those other options, except actually Emil Svensk, he looks like he's turned around, losing some momentum as he does so. Now got to go back up these steps. And Daniel Hoopman starting to stretch it out here.
That's the first time we see them splitting up here on this route choice. So it's now we finally can get an indication on which route is the fastest.
Yeah, here we go. These two groups, Gustav Berryman leading this one. I feel like he's going to have the advantage just from there. Yes, he is indeed. So maybe that was a better option, but still all six of them very close. And Gustav Berryman managing to stay in that lead. Wojtek Kral in next, Parfenowicz in third. Daniel Hoopman around that fourth spot. Skalé is just dropping back, and Svensk is feeling the consequences of that mistake out of control number seven. Number five, sorry, can't read numbers. But still all six of them together as the bells of the old town ring out for 4 o'clock. And now again here, we know there's some options to split up. Daniel Hoopman and Emil Svensk both going to the right to avoid this group of stairs. They will have to go through this very small passage, and Daniel Hoopman just missing that one. I was just about to say, it's really hard to spot that one, and it's very dark. It feels like it shouldn't be a place where you're allowed to run, but
like
it is.
If you're running into someone's living room there.
Yes, but I mean, that's exactly what happens in the World Cup sprint in Riga, that people, you know, running through buildings and everything, orienteers are now used to this being a place they're allowed to go. Anyway, Gustav Berryman there, then Wojtek Kral, then Parfenowicz, then Skalé, then Svensk, then Hoopman. Still the six of them with Berryman leading, only two to go through to the final. And they're all in fact going the same way now to control number 12. They're looking for another gap in the buildings.
And both Emil Svensk and Daniel Hoopman, they have to accelerate now because the position there is not very good. Unless, of course, they back out and are the only ones backing out from control 13.
This is control 12 then. So
now we see some risk taken there by Daniel Hoopman. I think he got this feeling that he has to do something. He's not capable of just running away from them, from the others.
But it's not paid off, this one. I think he's in fact lost a few seconds there, and everyone having to check. Now let's see what happens with everybody here. Wojtek Kral goes back, and And that's a good move from Wojtek Kral and from Daniel Hoopman. The two of them have gone the quicker route choice. And let's see what happens as they approach this way. This is Wojtek Kral, where we're looking into the trees for the others. Wojtek Kral, he's done enough with that decision. Fantastic decision for him there. Now we have Gustav Bellerin. Where is Daniel Hoopman? He's just there on the right of picture, but I think he's too far behind. He's going to be fighting with Emil Svens. Gustav Bellerin here alongside Per Finowitz, the pole. And this could be a shock one as Wojtek Kral already qualifies. And now in to cross the line. Gustav Bellerin takes the second spot. Fantastic running from Pivinovic to challenge the Swede all the way, and really great running from him the whole way round. So we have Wojtek Kral with, again, making that correct decision. And Gustav Bellerin just had the speed at the end as well. So they qualify into the final. They're going to join Chris Jones and Ralph Street in that final.
Very impressive by Wojtek Kral. He seems to like this kind of competition. He won the knockout sprint last year in the Czech Republic, and now he proves again. I mean, this was a very convenient victory here. I mean, it was quite a big gap there. He didn't even have to accelerate in the end. So it's that was a good race. It was tight for Parfianovic. Continued to do a good race here as well. It would have been a big surprise to see him in the final, at least for me. But as we said before, we don't really have anything to relate to. I mean, he can be a very good knockout sprinter, and we just don't know about it since we have never seen them.
And even just sprinters generally, we don't really know how people have been doing with their form, with their training on this year when we haven't had a sprint world championships.
And if you see that Hoopman, he struggled last year, Kibbutz struggled last year with the knockout sprint, so it doesn't has to mean that if you're a good sprinter, you're a good knockout sprinter as well. You have to be. I think it's very important that you have this acceleration very quickly and are able to take smart decisions as well on the way.
I mean, it's just from control number 7, the way you see Wojtek Kral just overtaking and had that little burst of acceleration that he has that he can use at various points in the race, not just at the end, not just on that last control where he also made the right decision as well.
I mean, it was a bit different between the race of Hoopman and if you compare it to Kibbutz. Kibbutz, you got the feeling that he is very active, he wants to be in the lead, but he didn't pick the right route choices. But Hoopman, you get the feeling that he doesn't really have the speed to do something as Kral was doing, to just overtake the others and get a better position in the group. But it's very obvious here that some of the runners, they seem to have a feeling for running in a group and how you have to handle these situations.
Very exciting. So we're going to move on to the third of three semi-finals with this start list here. And you can see them listed. And we haven't actually mentioned yet, a lot of the big names were out even after the qualification, like Frederik Torsson, Andreas Kibbutz, Martin Legborn, Tim Robertson, Sven Glibov. But let's go through this start list. Christoph Meyer, he is in lane one. Had a long time sitting on a leader's chair yesterday. Kasper Fosser, the Norwegian junior, the long distance silver medalist at the World Championships from in Norway. Fantastic running from him. And in lane three, Martin Hoopman. A big, has generally been a sprint specialist. And this really is a sprint specialist, Yannick Michels. Been having kind of a year more away from orienteering with this Forest World Championships. We've had Luca Basse from France. He's in lane five. And yesterday's winner, Joey Haddon, in six. So They're already looking at their options there to make their decisions, A, B, or C. There's really not much in it, although we do think B is that little bit quicker. So we're going to see what they choose. It's mostly kind of to split up the athletes, put them under some pressure, and they'll be second guessing, really thinking about the one that they've chosen. So we can see Joey Haddon has chosen B. That is a good choice. They've taken off the rubber band. They're all ready. Let's have a look at what they've chosen. Casper Foss has chosen A. We know Joey Haddon's chosen B. Yep, that's, there it appears. So too Christoph Myers also got B. So too Yannick Michels. Luca Basse has C. And Martin Hubben also C. So three Bs, which we think is the best option. I think we would expect Yannick Michels a favourite for this semi-final, and one other will join him on this third and final semi-final here. This men's knockout sprint, and they begin immediately straight out the gates, and Martin Hubben and Yannick Michels head to the front of this pack. Luca Basse is there in third, a little bit of elbows out as they jostle for position. Quite a long run out here into the start triangle. Martin Hubben has hit the front. Yannick Michels in second and really trying to get those that acceleration off the bends and really keep in a good position here. So once again, they will go past this start triangle and get split up. They know that this first part is the runner's choice. They've made their decisions, and they know from control three, they're all going to be running the same route. So Luca Basse chosen option C. So too has Martin Hubmann. And really got to be pushing all the way from the beginning. Let's have a look at see which way they're going. We know three have taken the B option. And different routes already taken here. Christoph Meyer backing straight out of that control. And we know from the other semi-finals, B is the fastest by a couple of meters.
Like 2 or 3 meters.
Yes. But if that means that you're leading the pack at the when by the time you get to number three, you don't have to put that extra energy in to catch up with the pack or change those positions. So
of course. I mean, if you look at the race where we had in the first, I think it was the first heat when you had Kibbutz and Chris Jones and Ralph Street and Tobias Pezzati, every meter counts. So they would have been happy to have chosen B there.
So Yannick Michels there ahead of Joey Haddon. Going round here, this is control number four. So Yannick Michels, really good start. Joey Haddon, we know he's got really great speed. Christoph Meyer, I think that is, in third. And Casper Fosser in fourth.
I mean, this heat is a brutal heat. There's two runners, Joey Haddon and Yannick Michels. They have an incredible speed. If there are passages where you're just able to run and push very hard, and that will be challenging for the other runners. And then, of course, when it comes into parts where it's more technical, maybe the others get a chance to close the gaps again. But it's tough to run against runners like Michels and Haddon.
Absolutely. And those two have managed to get a gap here. Myers in third, but they've all seen which option the runner ahead of them has taken. They know it's fairly even, just keeping up. And actually, most of them backing out. Not all of them, though.
We have seen before that backing out was good, at least in the last heat.
Mm-hmm. Yep. We'll see how that pays off. So the first two, Michels and Haddon, both backed out. The other four of them choosing to go straight on and along here. Now this is where we're going to see whether that option's paid off, and I really think it's going to have done. The fact that we haven't seen the others, Haddon just hesitating there, not sure exactly where the control is, but then they've really managed to get a little bit of a gap as a result of that decision. Of course, they're also running that bit quicker as well. We saw that from the first section, but Yannick Michels and Joey Haddon are good way clear at this point. That's impressive, this early start.
Even if it, you could see that Haddon was a bit hesitating almost.
Oh?
No, he lost the map, I think. He lost the map there, Christoph Meyer. Even if you saw Joey Hadorn hesitating.
Oh, he's going back to punch the control, I think.
Okay, hesitating and going in a bit too early. It means at least that he is reading the map actively because he could just be following, and it's also good for Yannick Michels to know that there's another runner actually reading the map.
So they go through, this is the really dark passage we were talking about. It's like you're going into somebody's house. It's very odd, and actually you're very danger of running straight into another runner with the gap that they have there. Looks like Luca Basse choosing a different option. But here are the two runners in the front. Looks like Martin Hoogman in third place. But these two have gone a decent gap over the rest of the field, and I think it's almost too much for Hoogman to be able to make up, even if he chooses the best route choice here. Luca Basse there into fourth place, Meyer in fifth, although actually maybe somebody chose the other route, the other option round, who are missing Casper Foster. So these routes here, Hoogman there two into control number 12, they're on this option very shortly, just going around all the seats here. And Joey Hadorn's hit the front, feels like he's got that speed and that navigation to go ahead of the Belgian. Casper Foster there in fourth, Basse in fifth. And Meyer with, I think, just missing the punch on the control, number eight, and that proving to have pushed him further down the leaderboard. So let's have a look. Hopefully we'll see which way they go from control 13 to 14. There's an option to catch up time there, but at the moment, Hadorn and Michels have a good gap on the rest of the field. Martin Hoogman at the moment looks like he's the only one who can challenge for those two final spots, and it looks like they've all backed out from control 13 to 14. They've all chosen that route, so looking very good. There's Michels and Hadorn, and they are clear of Martin Hoogman. They are going to qualify. They've all chosen the best route on that option to 13 to 14. So Michels and Hadorn both clearly qualifying for the final. Michels crossing the line first, and then Hadorn. Martin Hoogman's in third place. Casper Foster into fourth. Luca Basse in fifth.
Yeah, it's interesting to see. This was a totally different kind of heat compared to at least the first one we had. Here you had two runners, slightly stronger physically, not doing any mistakes, choosing quite smart route choices as well. And I mean, they had a gap quite early. They never let the others come back into the race, and then they get this, well, quite easy first and second place here. And when I say easy, of course, it's not easy in the matter that they didn't have to run fast, but it's they didn't have to get into this nervous game in the end and like starting to play tactically. And
maybe that's why they were able to take that better choice.
Of course.
And you can see they were both very actively orienteering, you know.
And it also felt that at one point when they had this big gap, they didn't run against each other. It almost felt that they tried to save up the gap back to the third runners. They were not really challenging each other for the first or second position. They were just running beside each other, at least in the last meter. So it felt that as long as we are keeping together and not doing anything stupid here, we are going through to the final.
Yeah, I think he just said we're safe, we have some seconds. Yeah, knew that. Well, there's no advantage of crossing the line first or second. There's no difference in it whatsoever. So, you know, if you can work together, both celebrate the fact that you've both qualified for that final, then, you know, fair play for you. And in the end, only 3 seconds back to Martin Hoogman, but I mean, they all chose the right decision here.
And here we see it. They already choose a bit differently there to the first control compared to Meyer and Fosser. And it was already there where they had some, let's say, 5-10 meters gap. Choosing a good option here as well, especially here when they backed out from the control. We have seen that in earlier heats. It's a good decision to go back from control 6. And here we see that Meyer, he forgot to punch the control. That's what I mentioned before with Hadon. Even if he did a, like, had some hesitation there, he was reading the map. I guess that Maya was not really reading the map there, so he was just following, missing that the others. I mean, with this air punching, you don't really have to stop. It's hard to see when it's the control is behind a wall, if they punched or not. So he was following, he was maybe a bit behind in his map reading and missing the control head to back. I mean, he was reading map, otherwise he would not have noticed that there was a control, but he was just a bit in the defense, like his situation was not attacking, and he was... Maybe he had some problems before, struggling with where he was or whatever, with the route decision, and then he was not there at the point where he could take an active decision, and he forgot to punch the control.
Right, so with everybody qualified for the men's final, we're going to move on to this women's final, and we can look through the course here.
Of course, now we have a different course here. more or less the first time after... quite similar races before. We start at the arena again, but we stay in this old town now. And I think it's a more difficult course, this one. It's more details to read. You also see these artificial fences that were built here in this old town. Three options again. So it's again runner's choice here, also in the final. We think that there's this the option most to the south. The straight option might be the fastest, but we have to see. Go back, and then actually they have a map change here at Control Seville. They have an arena passage going to a second loop again out into this old town. And I would say I like this course. There are many options to choose differently. Also, I think that the runner's choice will be kind of decisive. We'll see that later on. Not in a matter that you have no chance if you choose the longest one, but you will get into a position where it is very hard to fight back again, as we have seen in earlier heats today. Once you're there a bit behind, it's hard to get back when you're not in the lead of the group. And here, this is the runner's choice at Control 2. Those three options, and you see those artificial fences, they make it quite complicated to choose. My guess is that the route, the longest leg here to the very left, could be the fastest, because you can run all the way around to the right, to the east, and you never get into this narrow orienteering in this tricky detail part. You can go out and then you can push very hard, and more or less on all the different route choices you have to go and pass this control there anyway, but we will see. I mean, it's hard to predict. Also, we have been out there, but still it's very hard to predict what's fastest.
And I think that furthest one is good, but only if you choose to go round on the road and don't wiggle through with these artificial barriers. So I mean, it's going to be really interesting to see which ones they choose, whether we have a dominance on, you know, some people choosing more than the others. But well, we will have to wait and see. So these are the six women who are going to be competing in this final round of the knockout sprint. They've survived all the knockouts and now they're just racing for the medals. So some nerves here. This is their fourth race of the day. They've been warming up, cooling down, recovering the whole day. And now these six women are those who are on the start line here, being introduced to the crowd. So it's 2 minutes still to the start, and you can see faces of maybe some nerves, some concentration, looking at the compass, trying to keep that focus. Tereza Janosíková from the Czech Republic. She had a fantastic semi-final, taking a really, really aggressive running, very fast unit. Eleanor Ross here is in lane number two, the fourth place at the World Championships. Sabine Hausfeld, she goes in lane three. fourth place last time we had a knockout sprint. Natalia Gempele here. She's a bronze medalist from the European Championships. And came back after a little bit of a mistake to qualify. Martina Hoop is one of probably the outsiders on this final, and in lane six, it is the favourite here, Tove Alexandersen, the European sprint champion, second place at the World Sprint Championships. So they're about to make their decision, A, B, or C, for this final. And they're going to get to see this option. It's midway through the course, well, towards the start of the course, but not immediately at start. And these are what they see. So they see those options, those three options side by side. It's really hard to compare what is more favorable, what is more favorable for you as well. Alexandersen chooses C. So they're taking off the rubber band. They've made that decision. They had 20 seconds, just 20 seconds, to make that option. And of course, you can see there that none of them know what the other has taken. There's so much pressure on them here. This is the final with lots of A choices, only one choosing B. Jana Sikova and Alexandersen both have option C. And it's also good to be on an option with somebody running very quickly too. And that option C will be a good one. Right, a few seconds to see who will win this knockout sprint. And they are off with Housewit and Ross heading to the start. Jana Sikova is there too. And they do this really sharp bend around and out of the start for this course. Jana Sikova heading to the front. And Housewit there as well. What's going to happen? So this is where we can see what they have to do. Maybe a bit of choice to control number one, but I expect them all to just head straight on and go a little bit further past the control.
We already see that they are splitting up. I'm a bit surprised because you have to be very quick to take a decision there already at the start point. Since it's not a very bad option to go around there, I expected them to more or less keep together. Let's see. And we see them at the first control, maybe.
Oh, it's too close, really, to see what.
It was a good option to turn to the right there directly. We see that Alexandersen is up there, the leading group. And now we get into this artificial fence. It's not a very decisive one. It's quite easy to avoid it. And then we get into this runner's choice at control two, and there it will be very interesting.
Here we go, Jana Sikova is in the lead, then Housewit, then Alexandersen, then Gempele, then Ross, and then Ruch. So I think, to be honest, those two different choices, very different. But you can see here, the athletes haven't all made up their minds as exactly where they're going. You can see some hesitations, just having to slow down the pace here as they make the routes here. Now, which way have they gone? Housewit is the only one on B.
These are the ones going on A.
And A is the middle one of the three controls we saw on the preview of the course. But now they have to go a longer way around to get to control number four. And by that point, the others may well have caught them back up again. So by control four, we'll be able to see. And they go round. That's control six. They're actually going to be there a bit later on in the course. You can see this is the way they're going round. And this is good for Housewit, I think. If she chose that way, that longer way around to the left of the map, to the west of the map, that's a good option for her.
But we see also that Alexandersen still is there as well, so she didn't lose time on control C or option C.
And
Housewit in the lead, then Alexandersen, Jana Sikova, Gempele, Roos, and Martina Ruch.
So again, all together as they've just punched control number four onto control number five, now going down the slope, and they're now heading to this fifth control, Hauser's in the lead.
And from there you again have the option to back out from the control or to continue and take this small passage there. Everyone is choosing to take the passage.
And again, yeah, here you can go back round, you can cut through on this passage. And then this section, you can start opening out this running into control number six, really pick up the pace. I think on this other section, you've got to be really, really tight in control. So Tove Alexandersen hit the front, Sabine Hauser in second, Natalia Gempeler in third, Theresa Anasikova dropping back into fourth, Martina Ruch is in sixth position. Ross there in fifth still, very close between the six of them with Alexandersen leading out that group. And now they head to control number seven before we see them at the arena.
And we have seen a different route choice there by Sabine Hauswirth.
But here Alexandersen pushing up the pace. We're going to see who's next. So looks, Gempeler is there. So Hauswirth losing some time at that section, and Alexandersen's got a gap, and that is quite significant here. Jana Sikova, you can see her running is very, very good. Maybe losing some time with a bit of the navigation, but when it's that easier running, she's able to stretch it out. So Alexandersen has a clear lead going through now, and then they have a little bit of map of it. A little bit of a map exchange turnover as they go into this second section, running out the same way again. They round this corner and they go out to the start triangle again. So Yanisikova in 2 seconds, Gempeler in third, Hauswirth in fourth. Though Hauswirth, I think, just getting into back into third spot, bronze medal spot. But Alexandersen, we know she is so fast over not just the terrain, but also over the streets as well. She's simply running away from these lot, but there's opportunities to catch up and make some changes. Now you've really got to be careful. You don't want to get hit by Alexandersen running at full pelt. I really think not. That we can't see who is behind her. Alexandersen getting this gap here, and Martina Ruth choosing this different option here to control number eight, seeing if she can get a gap.
It's a good choice. We have seen that she is was at the very end of the group. That's definitely a risk you can take there in this position. But the GPS here is not very accurate, so it's hard to get any information out of it. Again, route choice to control 10. Will you back out or will you go to left to the south, as we have seen Hauswirth, and we have seen that Alexandersen chose a different route here.
So this is pack. Here, Hauswirth at the front, lost there to Alexandersen here into control number 11, running all alone here, just weaving to find the best routes. But she's got.
We see the control was there behind the glass house.
Well, the gap is growing and growing for Alexandersen, but that's a good choice there. That looks like Hauswirth to make a little gap there. Ross in third place currently, and now they're also choosing different routes here. There's definitely options, two different options to go on this section, but Alexandersen going here. Now we're going to have to wait and see what happens with those options, because Alexandersen has just had that great speed over the rest of the competitors. She will take her sixth win, but who is behind her? That's more interesting. There's going to be a fight on her hands. Alexandersen, an easy win for her in this knockout sprint, makes it look so easy. Yanisikova is here, then Rose, then Hauswirth, then Gempeler, and Yanisikova, such great speed to take the silver. Eleanor Ross takes the bronze, and a photo finish probably there for fourth, fifth, as Martina Luke also crosses the line to take sixth place.
Well, very impressive race again and again and again by Tove Alexandersen. I mean, that was after the semi-final, I wasn't sure if she would be able to just run away from the others. I mean, Martina Ruch was very close then in the same heat, but she made smart decisions and from the beginning, and When I think back to the runner's choice part, she was very fast, even on the control, where we didn't really expect her to be as fast as Hausswirth, who chose the option we thought would be the fastest. Also, the course setter thought would be the fastest. And then just continued. Once she has the gap, she is very good in just going on. And we also have to mention, of course, Janosíková. Very good result for the young runner from the Czech Republic, the junior still.
Yeah.
So the first top three for her in a World Cup competition. She was strong in all the races today, so and she looked, so it was not only that she made it through the quarterfinal, through the semifinal, she was very strong and active in every race here, and you could really see that she wants to be good today, and very well deserved silver position there for Janosíková, and then bronze to Elena Ruos. You could feel that there was a big fight between the three Swiss and also Natalia Kempele for the positions behind. But you got the feeling quite early that Alexanderson and Janosíková, they're very active and they're very strong physically as well. Also, of course, Hausswirth was active. But still, she had those moments of hesitation. You could see her in the pictures once or twice when she was standing, hesitating, reading maps. You could feel that she never got really into it, got the same flow as Janosíková or Alexanderson. So yeah. Here they were still together, more or less, in this part, in the beginning. But then you got the feeling that Alexanderson just...
I think she just steps on the gas.
Yeah.
She just has that extra...
But it's strange for me because she wasn't really doing that in the semi-final. But still, I mean, if you look at the capacity of those runners, I mean, the big difference is in a sprint, they come after 10 minutes, 12 minutes, and you had such a short semi-final. It's easier for some of the other runners to keep up with the space, with the pace of Alexanderson on a 7-8 minutes course. But then it will be those last 2 minutes, as we see here as well. They lose a lot of time in the very end.
That's a good choice. This choice going south of the line, around these barriers, proved to be a good one for the top two.
Mm, but you could also see Martina Ruhut took the other route. She was hesitating a bit, then she noticed that she had to take a risk and do something else, and then she wasn't really prepared, and you got this feeling that she was a bit behind in her orienteering. So I wouldn't take any two big conclusions just for this route choice there.
Yeah, they you can see the two of them were absolutely really attacking that one, and like that's what's so impressive. And I think with Janosíková, we forget that she is actually a junior. She's been competing for the Czech senior team for a couple of years now, and been putting together really good performances in all of them as well. So I think it was just a matter of time. She's performed really well as a junior too. So it's just a matter of time. But Alexanderson, number six of the year.
But still back to Janosíková. I mean, it's hard for a young runner when you get into a team. As a very young runner, she was running world championships when she was like 17, and everyone was saying this is a big, big talent. But then you also know at the same time when you're 17, 18, you won't have a chance to compete for the medal places, and you have to keep on fighting, and everyone is reminding you that you're one of the big talents, and that's not a very easy situation, and she handled that obviously very well.
Yeah, a lot of maturity in that race. So we will go immediately now to the flower ceremony to award the flowers in front of this crowd. Elena Ross getting great applause from the crowd that have turned out here in Laufen to celebrate what will be a bronze for her. And in second place, we've just been talking about this junior, Theresa Janosíková, getting that silver. See her athleticism really paid off. And another example of, you know, us starting to find out who really suits this new discipline in sprint orienteering.
And someone who suits in every discipline is the winner of today.
But I wonder if this means more to Alexanderson now. She knows that in the forest she's an out-and-out favourite, but on the sprint it's a little bit closer, and this format is a bit more untested. She's a bit less tested at it. I don't know.
Well, if you think back, the big opponents in the sprint to Tove Alexandersen were Judith Wieder and Maya Alm.
Yeah.
Maya Alm was supposed to run this weekend,
yeah,
actually, but she has a small injury, so we won't see her this weekend. But those two.
And Caroline Olsen is not here as well.
Exactly.
She's injured, and Lena Strand as well, also out with injury.
The biggest opponents, they disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
And well, we see some new faces here. Jana Svikova, of course, will be one of the big runners also in sprint. Maybe she has at least the potential for it. And but it would be interesting to see Alexandersen to compete against Maya Alm. We know that she might probably run the World Championships next year. That's planned at least.
Yeah.
So and then it will be sprint and will be something else.
Yeah, I think. Well, yeah, Maya Alm will be trying to qualify for the Olympic Games. But the qualifications are before the World Championships, before the World Orienteering Championships. She missed out on qualifying for the Athletics World Championships, which are taking place in Doha. She was aiming for the 5,000 meters in that one.
Of course, that doesn't mean that we shouldn't say that Tove Alexandersen is outstanding. It's just the difference to former years is maybe that her biggest opponents are not here anymore. So it's a different situation, and it's hard to see how it will continue in sprint in this discipline.
Yeah, I mean, you can only race those who make the start line.
Exactly.
And she managed to beat those who made the start line. So let's move on now to the final of this men's knockout sprint competition. They are lining up there and all about to be ready. You can see those five different nations represented, and that's a really good thing that we like to see here. You can see them lining up, just kind of getting these little nerves out. And but they've lined up here once before. They've lined up for the semi-final and now thinking about this final.
And I'm really looking forward for this. I mean, every one of these runners, of those runners, has shown something special in the semi-final. We have the two Brits, getting out the Swiss guys out of the competition, where we had a very, very good tactical run by Ralf Street. And then we have Wojtek Knoll, who proved that he has the acceleration. We have Gustav Bergman, who was running a smart race all the way. We have the sprint specialist, Yannick Michels, and we have the winner from yesterday, Joey Haddon.
So, Ralf Street there, lining up in lane number one. Chris Jones, European bronze medalist, British champion in lane two. Wojtek Král in lane three, winner of last year's knockout sprint in the Czech Republic. He really showed some great orienteering towards the end of that race. Overall World Cup leader, Gustav Bergman, in lane four. He had some good speed to be able to take that second place. Yannick Michels, so fast as well. And we've got some real sprint specialists on this start line. And yesterday's winner, we know he's very fast. They must all have some tired legs at this point of the competition, with still the sprint to come tomorrow. So these are the six men that line up for this final of the men's knockout sprint competition here in Laufen for this third round of the World Cup. So they will step back, they will make their decision. And again, this course is exactly the same as that which we saw for the women. So they're starting this choice. They've got A, B, or C. It's just one control difference between them. And they will have to make their choice. Only 20 seconds to do this. Some people I know have been practicing this self-choice aspect, and they've got to take their map. Joey Haddon choosing this B option. Chris Jones has got A. B for Ralph Street, B for everybody else. So everybody's got B apart from Chris Jones. That is certainly interesting one. Will it be best to run solo or in that group of five? Ready for the final of the men's knockout sprint.
We also know that the option Alexanderson had before, there she was as fast as Huiswip on the B option, was the C option and not the A option. But at the same time, everyone came together again there at the third or fourth control.
So they've headed straight out of the arena and into the terrain. And reminder, this is the same course as we saw for the women's finals. There is route choice immediately straight away, but they've all stayed together to just go straight on down here and we'll turn right then out of this. Oh, that looks like a mistake there from one of the Brits. I think it's Chris Jones off the back there.
He continued. He missed the entrance there. I don't know what he was doing. Oh, that's an abysmal mistake.
That is abysmal. He's out of that now. There's absolutely no way back for him. So Ralph Street will have to carry the British hopes here. And now they split up into control number two. Goodness me.
Well, I mean, it's... He has actually quite a lot of time to read himself. I think my guess is that he was preparing one of the route choices and was not really focused in that moment when he should be looking out for this passage. But at the same time, I mean, everyone else is going to the right there except for him.
So Wojtek Kral taking that one first, and these five all very close. So six is down to five with Chris Jones overshooting control number one. Wojtek Kral in the lead there. Then Gustav Benneman, then Yannick Michaels, then Ralph Street, then Joey Haddon. And this is this dark passage, one of the dark passages here. And in fact, they've all got the B options. They've all got exactly the same for this entire rest of the course, and all five of them staying together. Maybe Wojtek Kral trying to get a gap heading out at the beginning of this race, and now they're going to be very tactical.
Of course, the runners, they don't really know if the others have the same options. If they don't remind, if they don't remember which the different options are. I mean, they have seen every of the options, so if they are. If they have good brain capacity, they can remember that how the different options look like. But otherwise, then they wouldn't be very sure about it.
So they're through this passage and up here into control number four, climbing here. Wojtek Kral in the lead here, but these five of them, not much to split them up here. And everybody trying to keep focus on their own orienteering. Chris Jones is a long way back after that mistake. Be really interesting to see like how quickly he runs the rest of the course, but out of it here, still Wojtek Kral in the lead, then Gustav Berman, then Yannick Michaels, and they're going around the corner. This is control number five, options to go back or carry on, and they all go the same way. Not sure that's the fastest, but nevertheless, doesn't really matter. They've all gone the same route.
Well, we haven't seen any comparison because in the heat before, everyone went to the right.
Yep, in the women's final, they all went the other way. Now just straight on here, and maybe this is a chance for some of the faster, the stronger runners to start getting a gap. It's quite a simple section here as they head their way back to the arena. There will be an arena passage. So Yannick Michaels, then... Wojtek Kral, then Gustav Berman, and Ralph Street heading sharp right. Maybe they split up here.
Now I'm a bit surprised that a runner like Joey Haddon isn't trying to close the gap here. Maybe he starts to feel his body and feels that the power is running out. But I mean, there's still quite a part of the course left. If he feels strong, there's no reason to really force anything.
So Gustav Berman and Ralph Street here, and and they are still in contention, this group of five, as they make their way through this arena passage, and they will go the same way out of the arena. They're going to go past the start control. Wojtek Kroll getting a gap, then Yannick Mikkels, then Haddon, then Gustav Berman, then Ralph Street. That is the way it goes here as they go into the second part of the course, and not all of them, most of them going straight on.
And once again, Wojtek Kroll looks very strong here.
So Mikkels has taken the route choice, I think so, to Haddon, and they've got to go round here, take the right. Everyone's trying to move out the way, or failing to move out the way, and here's the control. And Wojtek Kroll doing a good job here. You see his speed, so fantastic. Then Mikkels takes it, and they've got to go through this small gap here at control number 9. Just 3 more controls to go now. And they've all got the same options here.
See the spectators, they don't know where to go. They don't have a map, of course.
And again, you can see they've got these same, choosing mostly the same options here. Round, they're going to find this little gap here. Mikkels goes straight on. I think that's going to be a little bit slower. But choosing those simple options that are simple, easy to execute. And now it looks like Joey Haddon just managed to sneak into second place as a result.
Indeed, it was a bit slower, some seconds there. Might be decisive seconds. Not very long to go from here.
And now they're taking these different routes. So Wojtek Kroll, Joey Haddon, both here. They've got to go round this building with the barriers.
And we are very close to the finish now. It's just around the corner, and then we'll see the last control.
So this is a race for gold and silver. Wojtek Kroll, Joey Haddon here. Ralph Street is in the bronze medal position. So Wojtek Kroll, he's going to take the win here, followed by Joey Haddon. Ralph Street is going to be racing against Yannick Mikkels. Wojtek Kroll gets it. Joey Haddon the second, and Ralph Street into bronze medal, just run out of it by Yannick Mikkels into fourth, Gustav Berman into fifth position, and Wojtek Kroll is punching the air, celebrating that win, his second straight win in a World Cup knockout sprint.
Well, trying to figure out who the specialists are. I think we have one there.
I do think we have
definitely
one.
Definitely. He looked very strong throughout all the whole course. A pity that we couldn't see Chris Jones in the fight here. He was out of the competition already after some meters, coming to the finish here.
Yeah, I imagine soon. He'll just be jogging into the finish after making that mistake to the first control. Just jogs in, and thanks everybody here. And I mean, Wojtek Kroll, you can see him really aggressively taking on that sprint, making the aggressive decisions, and yeah.
Something I really liked that we could see in the very end was this small decision, Yannick Mikkels, when he was rounding the house and not taking the passage. He lost maybe 2, 3, 4 meters, but he lost also the silver place there.
Yeah.
And that was exactly the place where Joey Haddon could get, could pass him and save this second place here. And again, it's such a strong performance here by Wojtek Kroll. We see also very happy Joey Haddon. Taking the second top 3 here.
He paced it really well. That as well, you know, he was able to take advantage of that mistake being made by Yannick Mikkels, so too Ralph Street. It's one thing for other people making mistakes. You've really got to be able to capitalize when those gaps open up and take everything you can get.
It's also impressive by Ralph Street. I mean, if he would have forced me to point out 3 runners in the top 3 today, well, he would not have been there, since he's always a very good orienteer, but I don't remember him to be a sprint specialist, and he's not the guy I would have pointed out to be the killer in the end when it's head to head. But at the same time, he showed us that he is might be one of the smartest knockout sprinters, at least, because he was choosing very often, very cleverly, and he was running good. Especially, I was so impressed in the semi-final. He did a great job there, and he deserves this third place here very well.
Yeah, I think it's really great, the fact that, yeah, these little route choices towards the end really made a lot of the difference. I mean, some of them didn't, but some of them, it's just that changing of position, changing those few meters, and that really proving to be incredibly decisive.
And it also, another thing I liked here, that we had six runners who were confident that they could do their own race, they can get their own decisions. I mean, even Chris Jones, if he wouldn't have been confident in the beginning and wouldn't have this attitude that I'm a good sprint orienteer, I can get this here, then he wouldn't do the mistake, because then he would just follow. So even if he did a big mistake, he proved that he has the attitude to go in there, do the job, and he wants to win it. And he doesn't only want to follow, but he wants to do the job.
Yeah,
and it was the same for everyone. We saw Yannick Michels choosing his own route in the very end. It wasn't the fastest one, but he was active. He wanted to win the race.
Yeah. I mean, you have to go in with an attitude of, I have to win this race. Even for the qualifying rounds, you have to attack it. You have to put yourself in that leading group right from the start. Otherwise, you just kind of drop off the back of everybody else.
And if I would have to point out some highlights here, when we see the highlights, some pictures, I was really... I have such a good picture now in my head of Tobias Pezzati. He was running his own race, running very smart. In the end, it wasn't good enough, but he tried, and he tried it very well. And also Ralph Street in the semi-final. I like that when he was prepared for this last decision, backed out, and got this, in the very end, this third position here.
Well, a very, very exciting day, I think, all around, with some really strong orienteering required to be able to win these medals here. So we're going to be presenting the flowers before the results are made official. So third place today for Ralph Street of Great Britain, managing to outsprint Yannick Michels in the final stage. Kepta made really good decisions throughout this competition. Now then, with his second medal of this weekend's competition, a silver now to back up his gold medal yesterday. Now two World Cup medals to his name. Joey Haddon has got the legs to be able to run away from the others. Really interesting to see what he does tomorrow. And he's really someone who's starting to show he is a knockout sprint specialist, taking his second gold of the two available in the knockout sprint at the World Cup. Wojtek Kral with the win today. A really aggressive race, fantastic orienteering, keeping in control. So Czech victory in the men's knockout sprint final.
And I think those three guys are also three guys to look out for tomorrow in the sprint.
Yes, classic absolutely. Sprint. The classic sprint that we now call. Yeah, I feel like I've started a thing that, but it is, it's more classic than anything else. And these guys to celebrate Joey Haddon with his family. Congratulations all round celebrations tonight, but still one more competition. As we said, tomorrow we will be having the sprint final for the last of the three competitions. We will be there tomorrow afternoon for the whole of the men's and women's A final, featuring, I'm sure, a lot of the names we've seen in the semi-finals and finals here today. But A little bit different sort of competition tomorrow, back to the time trial format. We will, of course, be back tomorrow. See you then.
See you then.